Divine Truth. This is session one of the introduction to creating loving ecosystems. The presentation took place in Wondai, Queensland, Australia, on the 24th of October 2012.
Everyone's fine. Okay, well, let's talk about the subject that I'm passionate about that I wanted to share with you. When you saw this first, this creating loving ecosystems, what did you think? Yippee. But what is it about? What is it? What do you imagine it's about?
Looking after the environment that God's created in such a way that everything from microorganisms to human beings can thrive in it.
Yeah, that's good. Has it ever struck you, though, that if human beings weren't here, the environment would probably look after itself?
Okay.
Can you see that even this idea that we're looking after the environment is almost an arrogant position?
Yep, okay.
Because the reality is if you took us away from the environment, it would probably look after itself better than if we were present.
Yeah.
That's a problem. We've got to address that problem.
So to harmonise with it.
Yeah, to harmonise with it is a very important thing.
Helping to recreate what was originally there, like the insects, the abundance, the abundance that God gives that
is now
really affected by our lack. So,
yep. That's very good. Go straight behind.
Oh, it's pretty much the same. It's just working with what's being demonstrated and try and replicate or duplicate what's already there.
Yeah.
In as much harmony as our souls can deliver.
Good. Kate down the front. Sorry, baby. Mary hasn't had any exercise today. She needs some.
About like short, medium and long-term things we can do to facilitate God's garden. So we understand it's going to work perfectly God's way. What can we do to get the ball rolling?
Yes, good. Glenda?
I also feel it requires looking at what we're doing that is harming the environment and maybe changing our ways.
Good. So what we're doing. Where does what we're doing come from, though? From our soul condition, but let's be more specific. It comes from what we're doing comes from what we're...
Well, I thought it'd be from the damage that's in our soul.
Right, yeah. So it's coming from what we're feeling.
What we're feeling, yes.
Isn't it? What we're doing comes from what we're feeling. So we're going to have to start changing how we feel as well we're going to address this issue.
Yes.
Can you see that? So there's a few factors I'd like to discuss with you initially. Now, this recording is going to be used as an introductory recording for every single person who wants to assist anything with a learning centre. And the reason why it's going to be used is that for every single project that involves working on the ground is because we feel that there's a need for everyone to have some appreciation at least of what it means to create a loving ecosystem. All right. So if we look at the term ecosystem, what does that imply to you? What does the term ecosystem imply? Sandra? And then...
I keep calling it ecology, which is really weird when this topic came up, but it, to me, just comes down to this feeling of a system where everything is in place and it's ecologically viable, so meaning like that everything is necessary for it to function, that it's once again coming back to abundance of species.
So it has to be sustainable and viable.
It's got to have life in it.
It's got to have life in it, yes. Okay.
Ready? And every part of the ecosystem, being it plant or stone or human, is participating in harmony.
So it's got to have harmony and balance. Yep, very good.
The relationships between like every living thing and how they communicate.
Okay, so you could say symbiosis. Is that how you spell it? There'll be symbiotic relationships between things that obviously we want to encourage somehow. I agree.
Living and loving intelligence.
Sorry, living...
And loving intelligence.
Yes.
Intelligence in...
Understanding intelligence in creation. This is something we want to talk about in a lot of detail later, yeah. So we want to see how intelligent everything is and what we need to understand. And most of us think we're the most intelligent thing on the planet, right? And to be honest, you are. God created you as the pinnacle of God's creations. Now, a lot of times we don't act like the pinnacle of God's creations, I know that, but that's what comes with free will. But if you examine it clearly, obviously we are the most highest intelligent being that exists on this planet who can be seen. Right? And if that is the case, then obviously if we're working against the other intelligent systems, we're not being very intelligent, we're not acting very intelligent, right? But obviously, if we were doing ecosystems, we would be in complete harmony with the other intelligence on the planet. And in fact, the other intelligence is going to also be in harmony with us. And this is the problem with a lot of it at the moment, is that it's completely in harmony with us. It's just that we're so far out of harmony with love that it reacts out of harmony, just reflecting our lack of condition. Yeah.
Also, biodiversity.
Diversity, yes, very good. Yeah, we want diversity. If we go back there and then back to Tim up the back there.
Each element serves another for a highest good.
Okay, so the system works in complete balance and harmony for the highest good of the system.
Yes.
Not just for the good of the individuals in the system.
That's right.
But all of the individuals in the system will benefit from that system.
Yeah, so they're all linked in a web of some sort.
Exactly. We are linked in a web. You know, it's like you say, there's mathematically the butterfly shaking its wings over here can cause a tropical storm. That's reality, actually, mathematically. Through chaos theory mathematics, you know that. So obviously, just a little thing can have such a big effect on the environment. What do you think the biggest thing can have an effect on the environment? By a huge amount, right, Tim?
I was just going to say resources. So understanding possibly chemical compositions plus water and things like that, food for everything.
Resources. Yep. This is just the introduction, so I don't want to get too bogged down in all this, but you can start seeing what we mean by ecosystem. Now, what do we mean by loving? Matt, thanks.
Giving to me, like if it was talking about an ecosystem, a giving attitude and actions towards.
So this is important, isn't it? The idea that love is a gift. Yeah. All right. So this is very important. Yes. Thanks.
We would take the time to understand and learn.
Okay. So love would desire understanding. Yeah. I agree. Yeah. Rita, thank you.
Could you also say how God created it?
Very important, because it's really about God's love in the end, right? And if it's God's love, it's about how God created it. We're sort of just a visitor, right? And because we don't live very long at the moment, we're just a temporary visitor that lives about 80 years or 90 years if we're lucky, or 100 if we're outstanding, on the planet. Now, if you think about how long some of these things live in comparison to how long we currently live, like myself and Mary, when we were in New Zealand a few years ago, visited a tree and it was as old as I am, as old as my soul has been aware, 2,000 years old. And it was just amazing just sitting down in front of that tree and going, just as old as I am and you've been on this earth that entire time. And what's even more amazing is somebody hasn't ripped it down. Everything around it's being destroyed, was being destroyed quite rapidly, but now this particular tree is being preserved. So, yeah, very beautiful things that we see. That God has created a lot of things that live longer than we do currently. So a sea turtle, for example, many of them live a couple of hundred years. Right? So the mammals are capable of living much longer than we currently live. So you've got to ask that question, what's going on there, don't you? Really. So with all of that, we understand that we're now talking about love, we're talking about God's gift, God's creation, bringing things into harmony with God's creation. The whole system should be in harmony. That's what we're talking about when we're talking about creating loving ecosystems. So what are the main things that we'd like to discuss about this particular topic? Well, the first part that I would like to discuss with you is this part about love and what love does. All right. If we understand what love does, then we'll have a very good chance in terms of replicating it. Even if it's an action, that is one thing. Obviously, that's a part of this. But, of course, love is a emotion, is it not? A feeling. So there is very little point doing things without there being a feeling of love doing it. Now, I don't know if many of you have noticed, but when we have certain jobs happening, say, at a learning centre somewhere, you start digging a hole and it's very hard ground and it's rocky and it's like you hit the, you know, pick on it, like you need a pick for a start, like, and you're picking away at it, and to dig just a small hole takes a huge amount of effort, and you're sitting there, and then up you pick again, and away you go. And after you've done that for a few hours, what are you starting to feel then, generally? Oh, I just hate this job. Like, why would anybody want to do this? From that point on, no love is present. You might as well just pack up your bags and go home as soon as that happens. Because we want love to be present in what we do. So it's very, very important for us to understand that this emotion of love is going to dictate a lot of what happens. Now, have you noticed what happens with things when love isn't present? I think I've mentioned before, but there was this study about children who were... at the time of birth, were put in a ward. They didn't have the parents didn't want them. They were put in a ward, and they were looked after by nurses. But they found that the child at the end of the ward always went better and was always happier, and always finished up leaving the ward and finding an adoptive parent and everything before any other child. And they couldn't work it out. So what they did was they put in cameras to see what was going on. And what happened was that the cleaning lady used to clean the entire ward, and then she used to go to the child by, you know, where she'd left the end, you know, where she left her mop and bucket and everything right at the end. She used to walk across to the child that was in the end crib and pick it up and nurse it and you know, for 5 or 10 minutes every day. So what do we learn from that? That anything that is loved flourishes. Anything that is not loved will eventually die. And anything that is not loved obviously will not flourish. This is important to understand. The other thing we have to understand is that the key, if we're going to do this, the key is going to be bringing more love into the system. Now, there's practical ways we can do that, but there's also emotional ways we can do that. Right? And what we'd like to talk about is some of the emotional ways we can do that. Now, if our love is present, what will happen? well, everything around us will automatically flourish. If our love is not present, then things get out of harmony, out of balance. So the first thing to do, so what do? We, let's say the average person buys a house, right? So here we go, here's our house. Little box on the hillside there. And it's in a yard usually. So there we have the yard. There's even a slight try at three-dimensional there. And there we have the house and the yard. And it's all barren and bare. Most of us, when we see that, will possibly not even buy the house. Because if the next door neighbour's house, same price, house is similar, but they have a pretty yard and everything done, we're much more attracted to that one, aren't we? In fact, when I was developing, they used to encourage us to look for the houses that nobody else wanted. And to look for to find the houses that were identical to pretty much any other house, but where the yard was terrible. Because it showed how unloved it was. And you know what? Most of us walk along that street and we go, yeah, that's loved, that's unloved, and I'm automatically attracted to the thing that's loved, and I'm willing to pay, if this were for sale at the same price, which one would you buy most of the time? If you were looking for a home, wouldn't you buy that one? Right? And this is an indication of how much of a lack of love we have. Can you see that? Because we're only willing to buy the thing that has been loved already, pre-loved. We're not willing to buy the thing that's unloved. And most people go, well, why would you want to buy that? That's the same price. It's got less work. But it needs more love. It needs more love. That thing would be better to buy, wouldn't it? It needs more love. And if you want to love, that would be a remarkable thing to do to that particular property, right? But we don't look at it that way. Why? Because we don't have enough love in our own soul to see the truth of that. Right? We would rather buy this, the one that's all got a pretty yard and everything, because we look at it as work and we look at it and we're more attracted to it. Right? Now, if we were coming along with a true feeling of love, you wouldn't examine things this way, would you? Can you see that? You'd examine things from a completely different perspective. Right? You wouldn't be going along from a selfish perspective and going, oh, well, it's the same price, so I'm going to get the better land house. You would come along with a more giving perspective and go, wow, they're the same price, and this one hasn't been loved at all. I'd like to love that. But how many of us actually think that way even? Can you see how much we have to change? Like, just for that thinking to change. Yeah, if we have a mic.
AJ, it was my understanding that if we're buying property, though, we should be buying something that we feel passionate about. So if we're not passionate about the barren one...
Why would you be passionate about that and not that?
Well, I know I'd be more attracted to the other one, so that's maybe dysfunction, but maybe because I like flowers and I'm passionate about flowers. And.
But you can create flowers there. So why wouldn't you be more passionate about what? See, can you see that what you're talking about is not passion, it's addiction. There's a difference between addiction and passion. Okay. See, if I'm passionate about recovering the land, which is all what this ecosystem's all about, right? Then this gives me the best opportunity to do that. If I'm really passionate about making the land change and grow, this house with this land gives me more opportunity to express my passion than this one does, because this one already has somebody else's passion in it. So the way I look at it is that's the one I want. That's why when 5 or 6 years ago when I bought the property where most people drive by, I was going, why has he bought that for us? And still do that, like a lot of them drive by. wow, now it looks like a minefield. What's he doing there? Like, right? And it's because it gives me an opportunity to express my passion far better than if I bought a property that was all beautiful right from the beginning.
So, aren't we more passionate about some areas, some locations, or is that all addiction?
A lot of it is addiction, yes. The reality is that every single place on this planet has the potential to be a paradise. That is the reality. We don't see it as such when we look at it, though. So how many of you, when you first saw the learning centre here, thought, whoa, like, why would anybody want to buy that property, right? A lot of you felt that way. A lot of you have expressed that to us, actually. And that is an indication that you don't see potential, right? And you also don't see the potential of the passion in your own soul being expressed and seeing the change as a result of what happens in your soul. What we often are attracted to is better than our own condition as well. So for many of us, if we passed into the spirit world, we wouldn't have our nice backyard. We'd have a bit of a messy backyard that's smelly and full of vermin and everything based on our condition, right? But we're not willing to face that. So on earth, what we do is we create a nice backyard in our own backyard, not realizing what we're doing, and unfortunately do not see the soul and its creation as a result. I am far more attracted to this than I am to that. This gives me the ability to express my passions and to actually grow them and to learn a lot in the process. This somebody else has already been passionate about and created a lot of things, and I'm just benefiting from their passion. Now, that to me is to do with lack and a lack of abundance and other issues, I feel, if I'm attracted to that rather than that. I'm not saying that all of us don't have a natural affinity to beautiful things, because we have been created mathematically with a natural affinity to beautiful things. But many of us have this emotion within us of we are tired of work. Right? How many of you feel you are tired of work? Is that all? I thought it would be everyone. Because a lot of us have that emotion in us that we are tired of work. Like, work gives you great opportunity to express your soul if you do it in your passions. And we need to understand that. But can you see that for most of us, even that simple choice of that over that, we want to justify without looking at the underlying emotions driving such a choice? Right? And this is where these are things we're going to have to change. Now, sometimes I see a very bad piece of land, what everyone views as a very bad piece of land. Nobody wants it. It's been for sale for 3 years. And I say to Mary, gee, I wish I had some funds to buy that. You know, that would be such a great opportunity to show what is possible. You know? And at the moment, there's some people that have been talking to us from the States who are wanting to buy some desert land in the States, which, of course, is quite cheap because nobody wants it, right? So you can actually... There's this place in Arizona where they have 1,000 40-acre parcels of land. 1,000 of them. It's in the desert, in the Highlands Desert in Arizona. And they get about 20 inches rainfall a year. For us, that's almost like normal life, right? And particularly if you come from South Australia, that's definitely normal rainfall. Now, you think about that. There's only four of those properties that the guy has seen of the 1,000 that have actually got anybody building on them. There's like 900 properties, 40 acres each, all less than $20,000 to buy, right? Imagine the opportunity there in terms of bringing some desert land into paradise if we understood the system. Like, I just look at that and I go, wow, that's an amazing little fact there of what's available and what's potentially able to be done with that. This is what love will drive you to see. Love will drive you to see potential and possibility where nobody else can see it. This is how God feels about you. God sees potential and possibility even when you yourself can't even see it. Yeah? And in fact, once you become more like God, you will actually start seeing the world like that, with as potential and possibility that nobody else seems to be able to see. Now, if we examine that, let's look at what happens if love is absent. In other words, there's not love, or if love is addictive. In other words, we have some personal addiction. It would be best if I spelled it right. If we have some personal motivation other than love to do something. Under those circumstances, the way God's created organisms, now here we're talking organisms that go right from single-celled creatures right the way through to the highest of God's creation, you. We're talking about all the organisms in between. So when I'm lumping all organisms, I'm putting them all together like that. Organisms where love are absent or where love is addictive, you know, there's two responses generally of what happens to those organisms. Anyone hazard a guess what those two responses are? Yeah. Matt, you want to have a go?
Kind of placating and rebelling, like going along with it or just completely unable to go along with what the unloving desire is.
Okay, let's firstly define the organisms. There's two primary, and of course there's shades of grey in amongst all of this, but there's two primary things that we need to see. Firstly, there's the type of organism that you could call extroverted or aggressive. And when I say aggressive, I'm not using the term negatively here yet. All right. What was the word that we used, I think? Yeah, aggressive, I think, right? How do they respond to no love? Any ideas? Now, if you feel that you're an organism who's extroverted and aggressive, how do you respond to no love if you're one of those persons? Give me an idea. If we go behind some.
Well, they'd either go out of balance or... Yeah, they'd go out of balance if they weren't loved.
Let's define out of balance, though. In what direction will they go?
They could grow in numbers to where the environment couldn't handle destruction.
They become demanding, in other words, don't they? They demand things.
Yeah.
Do you find that when you're an extrovert and you're a bit aggressive and you don't get any love, what happens? Do you find out, I want to be loved and you should love me, and, you know, isn't that how you feel? Right? What else happens? Any ideas? Just forward, foot around.
They withdraw?
Well, that's usually an introverted or passive response, but yes, they do. Withdraw. Withdraw. All right. Next to you.
The extroverted or aggressive will attack.
It will attack because it definitely will attack. Yep. What does the introverted one do when it doesn't have any love? When it withdraws, and what does it do? Well, those of you who are like this, you know. So
hibernates.
You can tell me. Hibernates, yes. Probably not the right, if we go die maybe, yeah, and then...
It shrivels and it dies.
So when you say shrivels, it withdraws it just, is one of the words.
Oh,
but
yeah, yeah. It contracts, it shrinks, it
yeah.
It doesn't display its beauty. It becomes hard to grow. It struggles to survive.
Can we just say one thing really basic? It runs away. How many of you run away? Every time somebody doesn't love you, what do? You run away and hide. Yeah? Right? So this is what things that are shy or introverted generally do. They run away, hide, You know, they can't be a part of the system. They don't reproduce as a result. Now, if we look at reproduction, the extroverted, aggressive types of creatures will go into attack and high reproduction when they are not loved. They feel threatened, and whenever they feel threatened, they react violently to the threat. When I say violently, they react in attack. So, for example, have you noticed what happens when you go up to an ant nest, you know, one of those black ant nests, and you just, you know, on top of it, what happens? All of a sudden they've got it up your legs, biting you, everything's there, right? If you go to a wild beehive and you just sort of hit it or something, what happens? They all swarm out looking for some kind of resolution, don't they? They've been attacked and they attack in response, right, to that. What happens when you attack, say, a little... have you ever seen a little pygmy possum or a little... which is a very, very small possum here in Australia, or a little glider? What happens when you attack a little glider? Have you ever seen what happens to that? It just tries to find the closest sanctuary hole, crawls into it, and you don't see it for a good hour or so. Right? And the reason why is because it just withdraws completely and hides. That's the other response to being attacked. Right? And these are organisms that are responding to love when love is absent or addictive. Now, let's look at the addictions in love. Let's say you have a personal cat. Well, straight away, there's an addiction, can I suggest to you. I'm not suggesting that you get rid of the cat because you've created the addiction. You need to live with it now and sort out what the addiction's about, right? And also, a domesticated animal has been purposefully built through years of scientific breeding. It's been purposefully built to meet certain addictions. You realise that? That's why you can't go out and get a tiger and the same thing works, right? Now, how many of you will go out and get a tiger and hope the tiger sits on your lap and purrs when it gets pet, right? No. You don't do that generally because it doesn't meet certain parts of the addiction. Right? Now, in future, many of you may be able to go out and have a tiger as a pet, but it won't be the same kind of pet as your cat, obviously. Now, if you look at the cat is loved, but it is not loved in a balanced manner. It's loved addictively. The reason why, it's had a role created for it, which you've created, or many, many years of breeding has created, in fact. And to correct it now, we can't just put this cat in the wild because it's just going to go crazy. When I say go crazy, it's going to eat everything and destroy everything in its path because of the withdrawal of love. It would even make it worse. But have you noticed that the cat that's loved also thinks itself quite in an almost an arrogance to it? Have you noticed that? It believes that it can get away with anything. And quite often, what do you find it doing? Bringing home a dead bird or a dead animal. Why would it do such a thing? Yes, Jason?
It's trying to give you a message or demand that you're not feeding me properly. Also, I'm talking from experience here too, that emotions, anger...
Can I say it's got nothing to do with feeding? Nothing whatsoever. Because most of your cats are overfed. Let's face it. So it's got nothing to do with feeding. It's got nothing to do with it being hungry. So what has it got to do with? If we go out the back. Thanks, Dad.
Reflecting our desire to kill animals by eating them and things like that?
Yeah, but many times you bring it home, you go, oh, the cat's brought home. So you don't have a personal desire to kill the animal. So... why is the cat doing it? It's a good question, isn't it? If we go ahead, Simon. Simon, straight. That one. Mary's closer now.
Is it bragging?
Is it bragging? Yeah. It has an arrogant belief that it is of a superior type of creature than any other creature. Right? That's what it has. And some creatures, particularly who are extroverted and aggressive, will go into this seeming arrogance. It's, of course, a cat doesn't have arrogance. It has to come from somewhere. It comes from a feeling inside of the owner that the cat is more important to the owner than any other creature. And because the cat is more important to the owner than any other creature, all other creatures are going to suffer as a result, because it's an aggressive, extroverted animal, a cat. If you loved, in the same kind of addictive manner, an introverted animal, such as a little possum, it's going to think that it's at the mercy of every other creature, and therefore attract attack. So it just depends on the type of nature of the person, or the personality, you could say, of the animal. Now, if we examine all of that, we need to see, firstly, that if we love, then everything would be in perfect harmony and balance. As soon as we don't love, everything is going to get out of balance. Now, if you love one creature more than you love the other, for example, if you love one child more than you love the other child, what generally happens? If the child that you love is extroverted, what does it normally do? It will start putting down the other children. It will start attacking the other children, treating the other children bad, and it will get away with it, right? Because you allow it to. If the child is introverted, it will feel terrible about being loved more, and the other children will attack it. They will feel aggressive towards it. Exactly the same kind of behavior as what you actually see in the animals and the other creatures that we have around. And by the way, the insects, the bacteria, the fungus, and all the other things all react in a very similar manners. We need to understand that. Now, once we understand that, we start seeing that if we attack an extroverted, aggressive type of creature, it is going to go into hyperdrive. It's going to go into higher reproduction rates. It's going to try to take over areas of land. It's going to destroy other creatures around it quite a lot. You'll notice this in amongst the birds in particular. You'll notice there's certain birds that are very shy, certain birds that are very aggressive. What do you notice? The aggressive ones attack the shy ones. The only time when it's different generally is if there is some kind of nesting going on, but even then the shy ones suffer generally. Right? And this is because of this basic imbalance that's going on. Now, if we understand that, that's right the way through the system. This is very important. We must understand that our lack of love towards any creature is going to cause it to do one of these two things. And it depends on the personality, the basically inbuilt personality of the creature, as to how it's going to respond. If we don't love, or we addictively love, an extroverted, aggressive type of creature, and I'm talking about anything, any organism here, right the way through to us, then there will be certain responses that we will elicit from that lack of love. And if the creature is an introverted type of creature, a creature that's more passive, there will always be an opposite response from that type of creature. And so we get these imbalances occurring in nature as a result. So everyone follows that? So let's look at this in practice. You all of a sudden have a heap of locusts in the backyard. They're chewing off every single plant you've planted. All that hard work just getting eaten away. So what do? You get out the spray it all down. And if you don't believe in spray, you'll get out something like pepper or something like that. Or you'll do something where that animal is prevented, without seeing that that animal or that creature is responding already to the emotion that's within. It's telling you something about yourself. That makes sense? So what I notice a lot is around here in particular is that we get a lot of grubs, caterpillars, on some of your fruit trees, right? Particularly, you might find your citrus being attacked sometimes by caterpillars. And I see people They don't spray that, and they don't. But they pull them off and squash, pull them off, squash, pull them off, squash, whatever, as they're going around the garden, right? Why are we doing this? Because we're not seeing anything to do with love in the entire process. We're not seeing that those animals are attacking this tree for some reason. There's got to be a reason. Now, oftentimes animals attack things that are sick. So we've got to firstly see whether the tree itself is sick. And the tree being sick is a complete reflection of our own emotional condition. Right? Secondly, once we determine that, no, the tree wasn't sick and there's nothing wrong with the soil and everything else, there's probably an emotion inside of us about being attacked, all of our hard work being attacked that we need to address. But on top of that, we don't see that these insects and other creatures that attack are actually trying to survive. And the reason why they're trying to survive is that most of their natural habitat has been completely destroyed already. So you know what we do in our lack of love? We go around and destroy the habitat. Then when we get attacked personally because of those things no longer having things to eat in their own habitat, what do? We then spray them and attack them some more. Now, the more we attack them, they've already been attacked once, by the way, the first time we removed their habitat, right? Once we've done this, we've now got this cycle going on where we are expressing more aggression and anger towards the organism, and the organism is going to attempt to survive. It wants to survive. So it is going to increase its activity to survive, not decrease it. Right? And this is why even if you spray, they've found in some countries, with mosquitoes for example, they spray the entire country. In Barbados, they did this for nearly 4 years. Every single year, just before wet season, they sprayed the entire country. The entire country, by the way, is only 25 kilometres wide by 40 kilometres long, so it's not too hard to do a country like that. And that got rid of all these mosquitoes. Do you think there's no mosquitoes there? Definitely not, no mosquitoes there. Right? The reason why is the creatures go into survival mode. They even mutate in order to survive. That's what they do. And this is what they've found with viruses, is it not? This is what they've found with different bacteria. This is what, you know, you go into hospitals now with different strains of, what is it that you get? Golden staph and so forth. With certain strains now, they have not got the antibiotics to actually get rid of them. Because the more you attack something, it responds trying to survive. Right? So we need to give up all of this. So what do? We understand the organisms. There's no troubles there. What we want to do also is look at this. How many of you water your gardens? Oh, everybody. How many of you go out and water your forest? Hardly anybody. So a garden deserves water, but a forest does not. How do you spell forest? All right. Can you see a problem with that? It's not that you need long hoses, you just need more desire, right? Right. When you come to our place, you'll notice actually today, I was watering my forest. But, right? The reason why is because anything you love, you will care for. Is that not right? So this tells me you don't care for the forest because you're not watering it. It's just as harsh, it's just badly treated as your garden. Why does your garden deserve more water than your forest? Can you answer me that? Well, it doesn't actually. You fell into that one. Does your garden deserve more water than the forest? The answer, if you loved everything equally, the answer is no. It doesn't. It doesn't matter whether you've got a veggie garden, whatever, doesn't deserve more water than your forest. Can you see even us watering our gardens is out of harmony with love? It's very hard to accept some of these things, right? Why is it out of harmony with love? Well, if we water our garden without watering our forest, now we're being out of harmony with love. We are loving this more than we love this, are we not? Why are we loving this? Let's be honest. What's the reasons why we love this? If we wait for the...
Because there's more emotional investment in the garden that we've created.
So let's describe the investment. What is the investment?
Because you've gone out and bought the plants.
So you've paid some money.
Yeah, yeah.
Paid money, yeah. What else have you done?
You've been actively involved in the creative process.
So you've had to, that dirty word again, work. Yeah. Yep. Okay, what yeah. else?
You get a payoff because you see the garden grow and flourish directly from the labour that you put in.
But why do you want that? You need to get
value for the amount of effort that you get that you're putting into it.
Okay, so you want food or what else? If it's not food, what else do you want?
A payback.
You want beauty. Uh-huh. Don't you? Isn't that what you're looking for? With your home garden around your house, isn't the two things you're looking for food and beauty? That's why you water it, right? Now, the forest is capable of all those things, of course, but we don't see that, right? So instead, what do? We have all this emotional investment, as you correctly point out, in the garden. So what are we loving more? Our garden. It's ownership, yes, but there's many things. But what is going to be the result? Our garden's going to get attacked more. Remember I said, anything we love more in an addictive way is going to get attacked more. Right? So your garden's going to get attacked more. Right? It's automatic, you're going to have things will come to destroy it. All sorts of things will happen. Now, sure, if you have spirits protecting your garden because they like you or whatever, then some of that might not happen so easily. But in the end, if you just pray to God that whatever happens to my garden is a complete reflection of my soul condition and then measure what happens over the next 6 months, you'd be very interested, particularly if you didn't water it. You'd be very interesting to find the result. The forest will flourish still, like it currently does. And what do you think is going to happen to your garden? 6 months later, it's going to be looking pretty bad, right? Because we've made the garden also dependent upon us. We've created dependency. Every addiction creates a codependency. Right? We understand that? Every addiction creates a codependency. So every addiction we have with our garden is going to create a codependency with our garden. The more you give it, the more it will demand of you. Have you found that? You know, you start making up your gardens, looks all wonderful, now you have to water, and then you have to put pipes in, and then if you don't want to water, you've got to have some kind of piping system with a timer and other things, and then you've got to worry about where you're going to get the water from, and if you can't collect it from the rain, you've got to go and create a dam, and then you've got to... And all of this stuff is creating more and more dependency. Does a forest need all that to survive? No, it doesn't. We've got to ask ourselves, if a forest doesn't need that to survive, so God's garden doesn't need all that to survive, but ours does, then that tells me that my garden's way out of harmony when it comes to addiction and dependency. It's way out of harmony when it comes to love. If I am going to bring my garden into complete harmony with God's garden, in the end I won't have to water it, I won't have to feed it, I won't even have to plant it. Because God doesn't plant it, and yet it still grows. So that's a bit of a challenging idea, isn't it? Eventually, that's what will happen. We won't even have to plant a garden, and a garden will automatically grow. All right. But obviously, we've got to change a lot of things from our heart first for that to happen. We've got to understand how that can happen. Yes, Jen?
Does this have anything to do with the difference between self-reliance and being reliant upon God's guidance?
Certainly it does, because every time we do this, we are demonstrating self-reliance, right? And the more we demonstrate self-reliance, we're in an addiction of some kind with whatever we're creating. And as soon as we do that, there's a codependency in what we create. As soon as we have codependency, we have something demanding more of us. This is why for many of you, you like you start your garden, you think it's a great idea. 6 months later, you spend 2 hours a day watering it. Now, God doesn't spend any time watering her gardens. So why do you have to spend any time watering yours? There must be a design flaw in the garden. That makes sense, doesn't it? If God doesn't have to spend any time watering her garden, but we have to spend all this time watering ours, then it tells me there must be a design flaw in our garden. Right? And this is what we're not willing to face. We want to tell ourselves that it's normal. And the other problem we have with regard to this is that what we have on this planet is not God's version of normal. It is our version of thousands of years of modification that we call normal. It's not what God views as normal. And you can just go out into a forest and see what God views as normal. Totally different to what we view as normal. Right? And I'm talking about a pure version, unplanted, unhuman-touched forest, not one of those line-by-line pine forest or whatever it is that we see. Now, what I'm bringing up here is issues. Can you see that many of us believe that, you know, many of us have difficulty loving one another, right? Would you agree with that? You know, some people who do things and they seem to hurt you and then it's hard to love them back and so forth. And we have issues with that. But many of us believe that we are loving at least to our plants and our animals. And what I would put to you is the reality is you are in addiction, most of us, with the plants and animals that we so-called love, and we don't actually love them. We are actually in a codependent relationship with them, just like we want with all the humans. The difference is the animals don't have souls, and so therefore they are going to respond in a more predictable manner to your addiction. Right? So all the creatures are going to respond in a more predictable manner to any addiction we have, because they are reflecting your soul. They're not reflecting their own will, because they don't have their own will. They are reflecting yours. And for that reason, that's why many of us love this bit more than we love people. Because these things give us things that we want more than the person, people do. Yeah, Jeff?
Isn't it a first step towards love to actually put the effort into grow your own food? Isn't that a start, or is that just the addiction thing, just wipe all that out?
That's the addiction thing right from the start. Yep. Yeah.
So there's no soul benefit in. It's not actually a step in the progression to take the effort to
provide
for yourself.
We convince ourselves it is, don't we? We basically say, yeah, well, I can look after myself now. I'm planting my own plants and so forth. I'm taking personal responsibility for my life. And I agree there is some taking personal responsibility for your life in that. I agree. However, you can't say if you love your garden more than you love the forest, then you can't say it's based on love. It has to be based on an addiction. All right? Can everyone see that? It's got to be based on an addiction. Because if we love one thing, remember I said at the beginning, if we love, quotation marks, one thing more than we love the other, then it's not love at all. See, if we were in balance in the environment, if we were balanced towards the environment, we would love everything in the environment. Right? So you know that, you know, big huntsman spider comes crawling up your arm, you would love that, right? And for those overseas, sometimes they get to be like so big, don't they? Like those spiders. And they're crawling out your arm. You would love that as much as you love an ant crawling up your leg, as much as you would love an animal or a bird or any other creature in the environment. I'm not saying you'd love it the same as a person, because the reality is a person is a soul and therefore a different creature. Right? But you would love the environment equally. You wouldn't have an imbalance in your love. If you love the garden more than you love the forest, these are both systems, and if you love one system more than you love the other, that's an indication that there's an addiction. Yep. And we were going to need to address that if we're going to ever create loving ecosystems. Yep.
When you say you're watering the forest, like we've planted trees in the forest and I guess water those, because apart from that we've just got iron barks and they're doing okay. So what are you watering when you say you water the forest?
The reality is my goal is to not water anything. The only time I water the forest is when I see a tree that's looking bad because of lack of water, I give it some water. But my goal is to not water anything. Why is that my goal? Because that's what God does. So I have to design a garden. If I'm going to design a garden, I have to design a garden that I never need to water, because that's what God does. If I need to water something, then it's already not what God does. With the exception, perhaps, if something is sick. Obviously, if something is sick or something is not well, I would look after it. Wouldn't you do that if you loved? Right? Surely you would. If something's sick, if you're sick, how do you feel when somebody comes along and gives you some soup or something that makes you feel good, doesn't it? And it picks you up and so forth. Wouldn't you want to give that to the environment? Of course, if you loved. But if the overall goal should be that, though, in the garden. So how is that achieved, is the question. Well, obviously, there's ways to achieve that, right? Igor, can you grab my backpack? And in my back of my backpack, there's a full bottle of water. I just need a bit of a splurge. Thanks, mate. Thank you. If we go, no, up there.
Christy?
If everything is in harmony, so also it would be rain and sunshine in harmony.
Of course.
But here it is not.
Of course.
So
why is that?
We don't need to water the gardens because it rains and the sunshine comes.
Yeah, but the reality is, I don't know if you've been up to the Bunya Mountains and stuff, but if you go to some forests, though, some forests are just as much watered as the average ground here, and yet the forest is teeming with life and the ground here is barren. So we've got to ask ourselves the question of why that's the case.
Because we destroyed here the earth.
I agree, but it's not only because of that.
Because we don't love enough.
Ah, yes, it's because of that. Yes, because we don't love enough. But the reality is there will be more balance also in terms of the delivery of what we need when we love more. The reason why is that the more nature is created, the more it attracts what it needs. And you know that, right? We've seen in the... up in South Australia, there's a part of South Australia called in the Ceduna. It was an area where they started to do broad-scale farming in the 20s and 30s. When I say broad scale, you're talking like hundreds of thousands of acres ploughed into a field and planted with wheat. Now, the farming land was called marginal. What they had to do was they had to rip out a heap of mallee, and they did that by putting two bulldozers with a big chain in between, and they just went through ripping out all the mallee. They put it all together and burnt it. And in the next few years, they had awesome crops, right? Because the cycles were still reflecting the presence of the mallee that had been destroyed. But as time progressed, the crops degraded more and more until now when you go there, all you'll see for many of the places, all you'll see is sandy desert. Right? What used to be mallee is now sandy desert. There's places all over the world where you see this happening, where lakes that were huge, deep lakes, in fact, some of them called seas, so big, that are completely dry. Right? And the reason why is because of what mankind has chosen to do. But also what we choose to do has a long-term effect on the environment, and we need to understand that. But if we address the lack of love, we would never have chosen to do those things in the first place. So this is where we need to address the love that is involved, or the lack of it. Right? Now, can I also point out one thing I've put down here too, is that all organisms desire survival and will adapt to survive. Now, have you seen that, like in practice? You can see that many times in your own garden, how things just adapt to survive. You do one thing and they do another. They do another thing and they do another. You know, they're just adapting to survive. And the reason why is every time we fight them, they are now needing to kick up a gear with their intelligence to go into more survival, right? So their natural intelligence, which is built into their instinctual system, and we'll talk about how that happens later, their natural intelligence is present and they will continue to adapt in order to survive. So if we have an attitude that's a lack of love towards an organism, it is going to adapt to survive. It's going to have to adapt to survive, actually. Right? Now, can you see that every time we force an organism to adapt to survive, we are actually being quite unloving to it? It's a bit like somebody coming along to you and you've just built a home, right? Brand new house. Somebody comes along with a bulldozer, bulldozes it down, right, with you in it. And you just manage to escape, right? And then they say, now go and build somewhere else. And then when you go and build somewhere else, they come along with a bulldozer and bulldoze that down, right? Now, this is what is happening to many of our creatures, is it not? Every one of their homes that they create, we literally often bulldoze down and get them to go somewhere else. Now, they are going to ramp up and ramp up their desire for survival. And this is what gets things out of balance very, very rapidly. So does everyone understand that principle? Now, the reason why I'm telling you these basic principles regarding love is because when it comes to the actual creating of systems in terms of understanding it, we need to understand the effect that these emotions that we are holding and these actions that we take have upon the creatures themselves, all of the organisms in the system. I would always ask myself, what if I this happened to me all the time? What would I like to see happening? Now, oftentimes I see people see a unique creature and they go running up to it, they want to take photos of it, they want to get real close to it, you know. Why do we do this? Some kind of addiction, obviously. Because would you like to be in some kind of, you know, field and then have hundreds of people come up and look at you and take photos of you? And would you like all of that? Probably not, right? And yet you expect them to like it. Why do you want that? Of course they're not going to like that. Of course they're going to respond. Now, if they're a shy, retiring, introverted creature, they're going to withdraw. They won't breed. They won't reproduce. There'll be less of them. If they're an extroverted creature, they'll lap it all up and go into overdrive mode. But there'll be imbalance. These things happen naturally. Now, you can experiment with everything I'm saying in your own backyard. So you can experiment with all of these things. Another thing we want to talk about just briefly about love, which is really about the opposite to love, I suppose you could say, is fear and anger. When fear is projected at an environment, it automatically responds to that emotion. Right? In lots and lots of different ways. Now, what I've done is I've listed some. Firstly, when there's a feeling of fear projected at the environment, they go into an automatic struggle for survival. there's an automatic heightening of reproduction without the ability to sustain it generally. In other words, reproduction that destroys the environment rather than being sustainable. In addition, everything that's afraid finishes up going into a state where it requires lots of work. Fear always generates work. So why do you water your garden? Because you're afraid of it dying. Why are you afraid of it dying? Because from experience, you found that the way you've designed your garden, it's going to die if you don't water it. Right? So fear has created the experience that then causes you to believe that you need to plant a garden a certain way that then causes you to have to sustain it. Do you see? It's like a great big cycle. It's like a dog chasing its tail, really going. We're going around and around in circles. Fear creates one response, and then because we respond to that, another response is created, and so forth. And in the end, we end up with a belief that is totally based upon the fear that started the whole cycle. So if I said to you, never water your gardens again, and you actually followed my statement, the majority of you in a week would have a dead garden, yes? Particularly with the heat that we've had the last few days. Dead garden within a week, right? Now, that will then encourage the belief that you have to water your garden. Can you see that? It's a self-sustaining belief. Now, if we said instead that we can create our garden in a completely different way so that it doesn't need any water, who'd be in that? Wouldn't you all be in that? But it's amazing how not many people have thought of doing it, isn't it? Why haven't we thought of doing it? Because we have the fear-based belief that's already in us that has caused us to create and design things based around the fear-based belief, which of course will always come true when it's not sustained. We create a system based upon fear that we then, because we believe it to be true, and then we sustain that system, we attempt to sustain that system, and of course that system will automatically die when we don't sustain it. We are creating our own nightmare and then believing the nightmare to be true. This is what we do with garden, with systems. We create a nightmare and we end up believing to be true. So if you went out to the average farmer here in Kingaroy and said, do you burn off every year? The average farmer would say yes. And you ask him why, and why do you burn off every year? Have you noticed all the smoke around, guys? Yes. They burn off every year, pretty much, most of them. Now, you ask them why? Because it promotes growth of what? Of grass. It promotes growth of grass. Why do they need growth of grass promoted? So burn off creates a growth of grass. Why did they need that? To feed the cattle. Why do we need to feed the cattle? Because we want meat to eat. Right. Now, do you know what happens when we burn off? Almost all of the intelligence that's above the ground in any area is completely destroyed. That's what happens when we burn off. Right? Now, it might promote the growth of stuff that's in the ground, but to be a truly self-sustaining balanced system, it's going to have to do both. The problem with that is it's only for the sake of cattle, and it's not for the sake of the cattle because they all die from the whole experience. So it's actually for the sake of our own addiction to meat that creates that entire cycle. Can you see that? Now, we justify, after a while we go, no, this is best farming practice. And then what do? We go down the track of we say to people, oh, the Aboriginals did this 300 years ago. Now, I've talked to Aboriginals 300 years ago, and I can tell you, they did not do this. But we want to believe they did because it sustains our own fear-based belief. Okay. Same cycle, watering the garden. Now, anger creates even one additional problem. So remember, anger is what covers the fear that's inside of us. When we're angry to a system, it also creates additional problems. It creates systems. So all of the fear things that, and I've listed some in an outline that you can read later, I've listed all these different fear-based beliefs that create certain things in the environment. And then when you go to anger, anger creates additions to that, because anger suppresses fear. So a person who's angry is not only angry, but they're also afraid. Now, as a result of that, anger towards the environment creates additional problems. So how many of us have been angry towards the environment? I have to put up my hand there. All right. Well, you think about it. You go outside, you know, bare feet, sit down on the grass, nice and lovely. These inch ants come along and start biting you. How are you feeling? Or you're sitting out at dusk, you know, and all of a sudden you get this nice swarm of midges come in, you know, which are little biting insects, for those of people who don't know in other countries. And these little biting insects come in and make your life completely unpleasant for the next 15, 20 minutes or whatever it is, right? And what do? Generally, instead of looking at the emotion that causes this attraction, what do? We get angry. You know, it's like bang, 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 and rah, 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 and then it's the sprays are out, and there's the wipe-ons, and then there's the, you know, wholesale killing of all these creatures because we're uncomfortable, right? Have you ever noticed that if you create discomfort in a human, what lengths they'll go to recreate comfort? Yeah, it's pretty amazing. We'll go to a lot of lengths. Right down in, historically, we've gone down to war in order to recreate comfort. We're willing to kill other humans in order to recreate comfort. All of these things are going to have an effect on the ecosystem. So, in response to that, what do we need to say? One thing, really. We cannot measure what we currently have and then do what we currently do in order to create loving ecosystems. We are going to have to change. We are firstly going to have to change our own feeling-based attitudes, and then we're going to have to change our practices if we're truly going to create a loving ecosystem. Can everyone see that? Yep, Natalie, thanks.
AJ, I was just thinking about you talking about the burn-off, and I've been to the Bunya Mountains and walked barefoot through some of the trails, and the ground is very soft and moist, and I was thinking about how you're saying that God doesn't need to water, and obviously the Bunya Mountains looks like a fairly balanced ecosystem, give or take.
In a little patch of it or so, yes.
Yeah. And then I look at the property that I live on, and there's been timber knocked down and there's big piles of wood. And my fear is it's a walking fire danger. But then I started to feel about what you were saying, and I realised, well, actually, if that was in balance, that there wouldn't be any dry debris. It would actually be nice and moist, and there would never be any risk of bushfires anywhere.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. The whole reason for fire is all about at the anger and rage that we have perpetrated towards the environment. And, of course, once we do that, we create an environment that responds to fire. Yep.
Thanks.
Yeah, with a natural environment, we would have very little fire worry. Yep, yep. It's our fear again, you see. So what's our fear go? No, well, we need to make a fire break, and we need to do that, and we need to do this, and we need to get rid of that debris, we need to burn that, and we need to do that when it's wet. And, you know, we have all these fear reactions here in Australia. And, of course, if you lived in a snow-based country, you'd have a different set of fear reactions, right? If you live in a country where there is no burning, then you have a different set of reactions. You're worried about what will be in the woods, what's going to be there. You know, there's just worries. Every society has its own fears that are perpetrated towards the system. Yep. Jason.
So when mankind created fire as a next evolutionary or maybe now a de-evolutionary step, was that like just a point of man still declining into...
No, fire is very handy, isn't it? But used under certain circumstances. Of course, it warms you, but we've got to also ask, well, why do we need warmth? It's because a lot of times we've gotten rid of all of the things around us that create warmth, and therefore we have to go and create warmth manually. You know, there's so many things. Like God's created all these beautiful things, including fire is a beautiful thing. I don't know if you've ever sat down and watched some dead wood burning. It's quite fascinating, and it's beautiful to watch. But if we're going to burn off wholesale, we've got to question the effect that it has on the environment. Okay, so we want to create ecosystems. What are the... So this is the next step we want to take. So we've looked at the love issues, and to be frank, I believe all of us need to look very deeply at these love issues. That's going to take quite a few weeks. You know, it's taken me many, many months to go through the process of looking at all the love issues, and I'm still reevaluating the love issues on my own property. Does that make sense? Every time I do something, I'm going, oh, how could I make this more loving? Oh, see, I've just affected that, and I've just done this, and I've just done that. That wasn't very loving, this. This is how I can make it more loving, you know? You look at things like that, you change how you act straight away. But if we're going to create a system, what are the basic requirements for every single living creature that you know of at this point? What are the basic requirements? So if we go to... everyone's name's just escaping me today. I don't know why that is. Sue's, thanks. Yeah. Yeah.
Food, water and shelter.
Well, there's one more thing. oxygen. Yeah. Food, water, shelter. Okay, well, hopefully oxygen's always a given, right? Hopefully that's always available. Not in this order, obviously. Water is the next thing that we need, isn't it? Any living system pretty much needs water. So it's really oxygen, water, food, shelter. Can you see that? Really?
Is it necessary to have sunlight at all for everything?
Of course, it is, yes. But again, that's probably a given. So what we'll do is we're going to rub out the givens and leave us with the things that seem to be variable, shall we? And we want to discuss this in particular, those three things. Have you noticed that if you put your own water near your own food, and that's near where you live, have you noticed how easy it is to live? You have? Yeah? And have you noticed, and I don't know if many of us here have noticed, but if we went overseas to some places overseas where the water is like 5 kilometres walk from the shelter, and the food is like another 5 kilometres in a different direction, would you imagine how hard it is to live? Many of us here have no perspective, to be honest. Many of us say, oh, we have a terrible childhood, we have a terrible this, terrible that. But the reality is, a lot of the people overseas had exactly the same type of parents, and in addition to that, they had to walk for 5 kilometres for their water and go 5 kilometres for their food, and many of them did not have a meal in a day, every day. Many of them still do not, actually. Apparently at the moment, it's about 1/5 to 1/7 of the world's population does not have food every day to eat. So they go hungry every day. So if you put water, food and shelter for yourself close to each other, what happens? Have you noticed what happens? Don't have to get too technical here, Ange.
We have more time.
We got more time. If you put all of those together, we got more time. And we've got more time doing things that are not involved with collecting water, food or shelter. So that means we've got more time having fun. All right. It's exactly the same for ecosystems. If you put their water, their food and their shelter near each other, everything doesn't have to go a long way to find it. And it's going to have more time. Now, what's the biggest fun that most things have? Sex. Huh? So what does it do? It goes into reproduction. There's more reproduction. As a result of more reproduction, it will grow to the point where it's sustainable with how much food, water and shelter is available. Can you see that? That's what it will do. And then once it gets to that point, if it's a balanced system that you love, it won't grow beyond that point. It will only use what it has, if it's a balanced system. So if our emotions are not interfering, it's a balanced system, and therefore the balanced system will reproduce to the point where it can handle it and won't reproduce anymore. But if you put the water, food and shelter a long way away from each other, its very survival is completely dependent upon going and getting all of those things. How much reproduction would you do under those circumstances? Not much, right? So how many of us, we go, okay, we're not going to have children yet because we haven't got everything ready yet. You notice that? Yeah. You know, we haven't. Some of us haven't got the partner yet, so that's a problem, but have to do that. But once we get the partner, we go, well, you know, we'd like to have a house. We want to get the right rooms for, you know, to have a family. And you want to have a bit, you know, most people nowadays with this economy goes, oh, you want to have a bit in the bank. You want to have a bit up your sleeve, you know, and for trouble. And then nowadays there's also this paying for education, which is really strange. But anyway, we do that as well. You know, so we even bank for the future for them, right? Now, don't you think all the creatures around us are responding to that emotion as well? And they go, yeah, well, why would I reproduce? Like, when my water's over there and my food's over there. You know, there are some creatures in our environment here that if you don't put the water, food and shelter within 10 metres of each other, they've got no hope of survival. Then there's other creatures, birds, for example, other small birds, that if you don't put their water, food and shelter within 2 kilometres of each other, there's no hope of survival. Right? So how can we make a system? We've got to make a system that allows for this to happen, don't we? Can you see that? We've got to make a system. It's a very basic principle. Anything that I want to help grow, I am going to have to help them with these three things. This is before I even begin to touch the soil. And we'll talk about soil in a minute, but this is before I even begin to touch the soil. You see, we'll talk about how soil is produced in a minute, but, yep, here we go. Justin?
Does this apply to us as well? Because generally, our water is in a reservoir that is kilometres away from the actual township.
But what do? We pipe it, so the water is actually right in our house.
Yeah.
So really, the water is right in our house.
Okay. And I was even thinking, like, with our food, it's generally grown well away from the major centres.
Yeah, but it's actually right in our fridge.
Oh, okay.
Well, let's face it, for the average person, right, we drive in a car, pick up some food, and we buy, what, a week's worth? And we put 1 week's worth of food in our fridge. How many ants' nests do you think have a week full of food in their fridge? I went out the other day, our ants were swarming, right? It was really hot and they were just swarming. And I said to Mary, they've got no food. They're just like out of food. And they're just swarming, they're going nuts. And so what I did is I poured a bit of food right near the nest and 10 minutes later, they'd eaten all the food and taken it all down the nest. And they're no longer swarming. Right? Wouldn't that would be what you would do if you ran out of food? But, oh, I've got to go shopping, you know, like that's our first response, right? The reality is all of us generally have water in our home, in our home. We have piped water coming into our home here in Western countries. We have food in our home, in a fridge or in a pantry. Yep. So the food and water is actually in our home. We have systems to bring it into our home. One of our systems is we go shopping. But there's a whole other heap of systems. You know, there's large-scale cropping, farming, all sorts of systems that create this ability for us to have it in our home. All of those basic things. We actually have all of our food and water inside of our shelter. The reality is, you can live in your house for the entire week without even going outside. That's how much we have put in our home with those three basic elements.
I guess I was wondering, is it better if we collect water from our own roof and have our own gardens rather than creating massive dams and having this broad scale clearing
well,
to make
Well, now you're talking about responsibility, which is a different issue, I feel. And responsibility, self-responsibility, is certainly an issue of love. But the reality is, why can't we create an environment where these things are supplied to us? We're intelligent beings, are we not? We're allowed to create an environment where things are supplied, things are given. We're allowed to do that, aren't we? So while, yes, that may be better from a self-sufficiency and self-responsibility perspective, what I'm stating is still the same. What you'd be doing if you created your own system is you'd have your food just outside your home with still you've got your fridge most of the time, so you've still got a few weeks' worth of or a day or two's worth of food in your fridge. You've still got your water coming into your home, or even though you've collected it yourself, so it's the same principle. All right? That's what's going to create your comfort and survival. And I'm saying to you, we need to remember that that's what creates the comfort and survival of every living thing. And we've forgotten that. We think that we're the only people that need to do this. And we stop a lot of the other creatures from doing it. Purposefully, actually. Yep. Which is definitely not going to create a system that works. So, you know, what happens when you get ants coming into your home? You know, those little black ants that come looking for food. You know, you get out the sponge, wipe across the thing, spray a bit, wipe across the thing, clean them all off, and then they come in, so you track them down and you put a bit of poison at the corner, right, or whatever it is. That's the average person's response, isn't it, to get rid of them? Put a bit of poison at the corner. You don't feed them, you do the opposite. You attack them. So what are they going to do? Go into higher survival mode. Automatic response to that emotion. Mary?
Just had a question surrounding population and reproduction that you were mentioning.
Yep.
Statistically, you know, we do have food, shelter and water very close together, and we actually reproduce a lot less than people in countries where food, water and shelter is very far apart. So are we looking at a kind of situation where animals are reflecting us in survival mode, so that's when there's a lot of fear and anger projected at them, they'll reproduce a lot?
When this is not together in one area, then what happens is we finish up going into survival mode, and that is a different mode altogether. And the human race goes into that same mode.
Yeah.
Automatically, yes. And so you finish up in populations that can't sustain high growth rates having high growth rates. And the reason why is that whole population is now in survival mode, right? It's now gone into this other mode. See, when you give somebody enough, what happens? They no longer have the emotion of lack. Once they no longer have the emotion of lack, now they can choose to enhance their life how they feel. If you produce the emotion of lack, the population automatically will go into survival mode. And survival mode is a completely different mode that we want to avoid that. We want to avoid anything going into survival mode.
So you're suggesting like helping organisms to reproduce to an optimum level rather than from a sense of being in fear of their own survival?
Yes, definitely. Yep. We want to, if we love the system, they love the organism, The organism will respond in such a way that it won't be frightened for its own existence. If we give the organism what it needs to survive, it will not need to be frightened for its own existence. It will replicate to the point where it's necessary, and it won't go beyond that. And as you'll learn later in our presentation, there's recovery organisms as well, and they have a different response. But what we're talking about generally here is that we've got food, water and shelter. These are the three essentials to our life. They are the three essentials to every other organism's life. And if we put them close together, this is a very basic fundamental principle, you put them close together, they will replicate, they will respond. If you take it away from them, they will go into survival mode, which is completely different. You see, most of us are afraid that if we go out and allow something to replicate and respond, that we'll get too many of them. And so we automatically have an attack emotion to them, which actually causes them to go into survival mode and therefore have too many of them. It's the actual emotion of our fear that creates too many of them. And we need to understand that. If we did not have any fear, we wouldn't feel afraid that there'd be too many of them. And they would not feel our desire to harm them or destroy them in any way. And as a result, there won't be too many of them. They'll be in perfect balance. Remember, if you love one thing over another, it creates an imbalance. If you dislike or fear or are angry towards one thing over another, it's going to create imbalance. These are basic fundamental principles of what I'm trying to get across to create loving ecosystems. So before we actually go and do anything, we have to understand these things. Before we do anything. Yeah, Natalie?
So then based on that principle, there's dog baiting occurring out where I live at the moment.
Yep.
And so the fear of people's livestock being taken by the dogs, and then they set the baits out to try and kill them off, actually causes them to reproduce more because they're going into that survival mode.
Yes, but on top of that, we have an additional problem. These dogs were created as domestic animals. They were bred with certain characteristics and tendencies, which we then gave them through a long process of human history. Right? So we've got bigger problems than just what's happening right now. We've got big problems with dogs, cats, and all of these kind of things. A lot of these kind of animals were domesticated. Cattle, sheep, goats, dogs, cats, chickens, all these animals that are domesticated. If we make a list of them, we're not going to solve this problem overnight, because they have a long line of damage, a long line of inbuilt, inbred damage that we are going to have to help them change. We're going to have to unbreed them from. Does that make sense? We're going to have to reverse what we've been doing if we're going to change it. So we can't expect that a single thing is going to solve the problem. So this is why I can't suggest to not bait the dogs, because the dog issue itself is based upon a long line of bad decisions that we need to reverse if we're truly going to solve the problem. Now, what man wants to do, they want to come along and bait the dog and kill it, but that doesn't solve the problem. That's why we keep on baiting every year, right? Because you're now attacking the system. It's not going to solve the problem, right? So we've got bigger problems than that, and some of these problems are going to take longer periods of time to resolve. You know, some of these animals are going to struggle to survive, or there'll be too many of them until we sort out these issues that created them.
And that comes back to our issues of love.
It always comes back to our issues of love. If you look at why we created dogs, there's a lot of things in emotions as well as demands.
Yep. I've always been curious about where domesticated animals came from. Like, if God creates such variety with plants and all these different life forms, then, like, I have horses and...
Horses are very similar to dogs, cats.
So, yep. Obviously, at some point I recognised that horses were wild, but my, I guess what I'm saying is all the animals that we've domesticated, were they at some point wild and...
Yes.
Not dependent upon humans to feed them and look after them.
Yes, they're all not dependent.
So we have to learn how to...
But But we can't take away their dependency immediately now, can we? Because they die.
Yeah.
We've created their dependency. We now have to go through a process with them to undo the dependency.
Okay.
It's not loving to just take away the dependency after we've created it.
No, yeah.
And particularly not loving to do it if we haven't dealt with the emotional reason why we created the dependency in the first place.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Yeah. Matt?
So would it potentially be a loving thing maybe to go around and round up these dogs and provide them food, water and shelter and help to wean them off that system rather than just they're out now, then we're not supporting them and they're being destructive?
Yeah, and it's also loving probably to neuter them, to be honest.
Yeah.
Like, so that they don't keep on reproducing in their current form. Like, and when I say that, a lot of people go, what? What is he talking about? The reason why is because we created them like they currently are. We need to take steps now to undo what we've created. And some of those steps are not going to look that loving. That's the reality. And the reason why is because we need to feel about the unloving behaviour. Now, once we do this, right, once we do feel about the unloving behaviour, their behaviour will change anyway. So they won't go around killing. Why do they go around killing livestock? It's quite obvious from what I've just said. What are livestock? They're generally more shyer, retiring, introverted type of animals. What are dogs? Generally more extroverted animals. We're loving our livestock more than the dogs, are we not? So, of course, what are the dogs going to do? Attack the livestock. Down in Kentucky, they've just been doing some experiments with this, like about foxes, for example. They've stopped. They used to kill all their foxes, and now they don't kill their foxes. And now they're finding they have less foxes. Work that out. You don't kill the foxes, and you've got less foxes on your property. Why did that happen? Like, it's because of the foxes now feel safe. They now can do their own thing. Many of them are now starting to eat insects rather than animals and so forth. And so there's less destruction from them. Yeah? They adapt. They adapted one way, they can adapt back the other way. Do you understand? If they adapted one way, they can certainly go back the other way. It just depends on our condition, what we do. Yeah? So we need to understand that. Okay.
It's interesting you're talking about the dogs and the animals. There's a show in America that's just been released called Revolution, and it's 15 years in the future after all the power stops and there's no power in the cities.
Yep.
So all the domestic animals and the humans left the cities to grow food and where it was safer. But the animals went and followed the humans too, and all the dogs inbred and got bigger and started chasing the humans for food. So yeah. It sort of a backfired.
Yep.
So they're still living in fear because of all the domestic animals that are wild, and they're growing corn and potatoes to survive, but there's humans are mixing with militia groups and that. So the humans are hunting humans for food, and the dogs are hunting humans for food. It's pretty messy, actually.
So this is like a movie, is it, of some kind?
It's a new series that's just come out from America called Revolution.
Yep.
But it's interesting. There's a group of people trying to create ecosystems, and you can see that they're trying to do it in a loving way, put the water and the shelter and the food together. But every now and then something comes from outside the system to attack them.
Of course.
And that's when you were talking there, I've only watched one show of this, and I'm just thinking, oh, this would be a good one for everyone to watch.
Yeah.
Because it's like post-apocalypse. There's no power, that the cars can't go, so they use the horses to pull the cars, and then they sit in the car. And they wave at people in the villages and that, like you'd normally drive past in a car. But these horses are really sweating, you know, because there's some big cars, all those American RVs that they have to pull around.
Yeah.
So there's a bit of sadness there because they're still reliant on these animals. It's still a lot, like the aggression never went. They never got the teachings of divine love, obviously, when they produced the film.
Yeah.
But
But it's an interesting reflection of the state of humanity in its current condition, because that's exactly what we would do in our current condition. Yeah. If there was some apocalypse of some kind or some change in the way that we had to live, we would revert to using exactly the same techniques in an unloving manner, just with the resources that we had available.
Yeah, so have a look for it, guys. Revolution.
All right, sounds interesting. So everyone can see that scarcity, things are going to respond to. Abundance, things are going to respond to. If you have an emotion of lack, then things are going to respond to that and obviously take more from you so that you feel the emotion of lack. These are all normal things that will happen. Alex, thanks.
AJ, if you come into a state of at-one-ment, will everything around you just perfect itself? Or?
Of course, but the way that this happens is through your emotions changing, right? And of course, once your emotions change, your actions will change automatically. So don't think that at-one-ment is just a state without actions changing. Do you follow what I'm saying?
So you still got to work.
So when you say work, I don't know if I'd call it work anymore, because it's desire that drives everything you do, not work. You know what I mean? So like the way I even look at work now, I don't look at it as work. It's either a decision about desire or not. Do I have a desire to do it or don't I? If I don't, then I don't. If I do, then I do. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I know what you mean. I'm starting to get the same feeling myself.
Yeah, so the reality is, when we become at one with God, we will still be working, but we won't even see it as work.
Yeah, it's just desires.
It'll be just this desire being, this is what I want to do here, this is what I want to do there, and you go and do it because you want to. You don't even see life as work anymore. Yeah? Work happens because we've yet to grieve. The feeling of work is because we're yet to grieve something. Because once we've grieved it, we no longer have a feeling of work. We only do what we desire anyway, and we no longer feel it's work.
I guess I've got this thing that a woman is kind of like this magical place where you kind of wave a wand and, you know, the weed turns into a rose bush and that kind
of right,
thing.
Okay. No, the weed's great.
Yeah.
See, a woman is you'd understand what the role of the weed is. It wouldn't turn into a rose bush. Yeah. Let me illustrate. Deep clay soil needs to be broken up somehow, right? If you've got water, you'll find that in deep clay soil, generally, the big Scotch thistles will grow, right? Now, I look at that and I go, wow, that's fantastic. I've actually suggested to some people to seed their property with Scotch thistles. They think I'm nuts, right? These are big thistles that grow, so you know them, all prickly. Why? Because they have a specific loving role to certain types of soil that without them, you're not going to recover anything very well. You'll have to pump it full of fertilizer, till it, book holes in it, and all sorts of things to get the same effect. They have a big tubular root that drives down sometimes quite a few feet deep and breaks up the soil. Right, and you can't get that effect by anything other than some very, very deep ploughing. These created automatically, and on top of that, provide a layer of mulch once they seed. And they have, like, in a seed head, you've seen the seed heads? Thousands of seeds. Like, why harvest wheat when you can harvest Scotch thistle? Actually help an entire area of the environment.
Supposedly all edible too.
Sorry?
It's supposedly all edible.
Yes, of course.
I haven't had a go yet. But
yeah, of course. The prickles might be a bit difficult. And why do plants have prickles? See, this is something they've also evolved. Why? Because they keep getting attacked and keep getting attacked. Eventually they evolve thistles so that they're no longer attacked. And when they're no longer attacked, they can do the job they were designed to do. So do you think, once we stop attacking plants and animals that we don't like, can you see how they'll just start dropping their protection schemes? Now, that's not going to happen before you drop yours, but So it just matters about how far we drop our protection schemes, then they'll start dropping their protection schemes. Does that make sense? Yeah. Remember, things evolve. They change genetically as a result of our emotions. We must understand this. This is a part. So if things have evolved genetically to this point because of our lack of love in our emotions, then once we bring our emotions into a harmony with love, then surely they're just going to evolve back. Can you see that? Why would that not be the case? If it's involved one direction, it can evolve in the other direction just as easily. Yeah. And in fact, if that was its original design, it also has a memory of its original design. So the chances are of evolving back much more rapidly than it evolved is much higher, because it actually has a memory of where it came from. These are all things we need to understand about the issue of love. If we go to Liam and then down.
So plants such as Scotch thistles, you said they're there for that job. Once that job is then done, we no longer have Scotch thistles there and other things can grow in place.
Yeah, it won't be that you have to remove them. The seed will go dormant inside the ground. It will just lay there, and it can lay there for many hundreds and sometimes thousands of years in the ground, and it will not come up again until there's a role, until there's a specific problem with the soil and the environment that particular plant needs to grow. And then, bang, she'll come up. And the reason why is because the plant has intelligence. Every living thing has intelligence. So, see, we've got to take a lot of care with this. And this is something that I wanted to bring up with next. It was really point number three in this discussion. Intelligence. Is in every living thing. So a Scotch thistle, which is treated as a weed, has intelligence. It's only going to grow in certain locations because of its intelligence. Does everyone understand that? Now, the more the animal has self-determination, or the more the organism has self-determination, the more intelligence it has. So if we look at collective intelligence versus individual intelligence, humankind is the pinnacle of individual intelligence. From there, we scale right the way down to the smallest of living organisms, and they have the most collective intelligence. So we have the most individual intelligence. They have the most collective intelligence. Now, if we look at a nest of ants, how much intelligence they have? Individual intelligence? Not much. Collective intelligence? A lot more. I would argue that its individual intelligence, though, is quite high. Right? Its instinctual intelligence is quite high. As we go up to mammals, its individual intelligence is much higher, its collective intelligence is much lower. In other words, it has a bit more self-determination. It reflects the self-determination of its own existence. Until we get to a human who reflects its own self-determination, but still has quite a lot of collective intelligence. Do you understand? Like, there's still collective intelligence, but it has the highest level of individual intelligence. Now, intelligence is inbuilt in every living system compared to every dead system. You know what we do? We create dead systems and dead systems are completely dependent upon our own intelligence. If we create living systems, it's no longer completely dependent upon our own intelligence, because every living creature in the living system has its own intelligence. Does everyone get that? So the dead systems can only give certain things. The living systems are much more intelligent. They are going to do much better. Now, you've all built a house, yes? Most of you have a house to live in. It's a dead system. For the majority of you, it's a dead system. It's made of dead material that has been harvested, grown, chopped down, used. What do you call it when you melt it and refine it? Forget the term now. Process it. We just call it processing, but it's actually smelting, that's right. Smelted and so forth. These are all things that have happened to all the materials in our system. There's no life in our system at all except for the subatomic life that's present and the atomic life that's present. Aside from that, there's no other form of life present in those dead systems. So you know what God did? God designed living systems. And you know what God gave the living systems to eat? Yeah, the dead systems. Now you think about that. Your house is a dead system. You've just given a lot of creatures a lot of food that they're going to now try to attack and completely decompose so that they can turn it into food for living systems. That's what they're going to do. And unless you stop them, that's a given. It's definitely going to happen. And when you die and nobody takes over your home, it's definitely going to happen. Within 100 or a couple of 100 years, unless it's built out of rock, most of it won't be there anymore. Because the living systems will have eaten it and turned it into systems for life. It's a clever little system God has made, isn't it? If you think about it. So we should only view dead systems as food for living systems. So the only way to really view your homes at the moment is that it's food for living systems. You can't get angry with the living systems for attacking it because they have been programmed to do so. It's their natural instinctual behavior to do so. So we're going to have to change how we design things, are we not? Also, this is a great thing to understand in terms of improving the living systems, because all we need to do is feed them with dead systems. So you can chuck a rock on the ground and you'll have a living system come underneath it. Doesn't have to be organic even. Can be dead like a rock, but seemingly dead. And a living system will begin underneath it. Does that make sense? You can throw a piece of tin on the ground and a living system will start underneath it. Might take 150, 200 years for that tin to decompose, but the living system will do its job eventually. And it will use it as shelter and a bit of food and a bit of other things as it goes. With a rock, thousands of years it's going to last sitting on that living system. Shelter for a living system. Rocks are great. They're shelter for living systems. Yeah. And they decompose slowly, which is great too, isn't it? We can use that for our own homes if we want. There's not many living systems that will eat rock. There's a few, but not many. Chemical processes that are living systems. Eagle?
Just out of the curiosity, can you give us a picture of the living house?
Of a living house?
Yeah.
And a living house would be built of either dead systems that take a very, very long time to decompose, like rocks, or they'll be composed of completely alive systems, so trees, things like that, that would be built that you could survive inside of. But for the majority of us, we're afraid of all the other living creatures that might exist in there with us. So we don't like that idea. But imagine if you had no fear at all about any living creature, can you see that you'd be able to lie out in the forest without getting eaten by an insect? Right? Because you're an alive creature. The living systems don't go for living systems. The reason why they're going for you now is because they think you're on your way to dying anyway. And you are. That's what they feel. They can feel these emotions in you that are killing you. And what does a living system do to anything that's on the way to death? Helps it on its way. That's what it does. So once you become at one with God, or once you become even in this place of love for everything, you'll find that the living systems will just all leave you alone. Because it's automatic for them to leave you alone. Have you noticed in a garden where things are growing really, really good, hardly anything ever touches it? You know, often it's the veggie that you like the least. Have you noticed that too? The vegetable that you like the least goes healthy and abundant and everything. So what do you think that is? It's all to do with our emotional projections upon the other vegetables. But there's this abundant one and nothing seems to eat it. Like the kangaroos come along, they leave it alone, and then this one that we're protecting that we really like, bang into that. You know, have you noticed that? These are all parts of what happens to systems because of our projections at them. And this is why we need to understand that. Jen?
Is it true then, at the point of becoming at one with God, we ourselves become a living system?
Well, we are already a living system, but the problem is that we are a living system at the moment with a lot of things that are dying in us. You know, we have the death gene in our very genetic structure as a result of our soul condition. And of course, that is going to attract things that are about us dying sooner or later. But yes, once you're at one with God, you are completely alive and therefore a complete living system that other systems will just respect completely. Simon? Just leave your hand up, Simon, and that's it. So.
I was just wondering, a little while ago I had a feeling around as we progress as a human race, that the animals underneath us, intelligence lifts with that. Is that true as well?
Yes, their ability to do their best job is automatically increased by our intelligence and allowance increasing. So you think of it at the moment, most of the living creatures around us are not allowed to do their job that they've been created to do. So, for example, going back to Scotch thistle, what do? With it? We cut it down generally, or dig it up or something. We don't allow it to do the job. And so what does that mean? We've got to do the job. The beauty of the thing about all of this intelligence is, if we have all of this intelligence working for us, it's like having armies. Imagine every single ant on a 40-acre property. How many ants would that be? It'd be billions and billions and billions, wouldn't it? You know, on a little property. You imagine every single ant working in harmony with your desire. Now, that's a lot of workers. You see how fast they can work? Man, they're just like amazing. And do you see how much they can lift? What is it? They can lift some incredible figure times their own weight, 20 times or something their own weight, some incredible figure. Have you seen? They can drop from the top of a building to the ground and not get hurt. Can you do that? Like, you can't even drop the same drop and not get hurt that they can drop. Like, these are all these creatures that all have these inbuilt qualities and intelligence that all could be working for you. And instead, what are they doing now? Working against you. Right? If we understand that every single thing that has intelligence has a purpose for its design and creation, and therefore has a role in a completely balanced system. A weed has a role in a completely balanced system. Now, unfortunately, again, mankind has genetically modified things and therefore created roles for other organisms, right? Without understanding the full impact of that. However, there is still intelligence even in the genetically designed creatures and systems. And if we understand the intelligence that's in every system and we bring ourselves into harmony with love with that intelligence, the intelligence will work for us and not against us. Now we have literally billions and billions and billions of organisms in our own backyard all working for us, not against us. So do you think you're going to need to spray anything and pick off the grubs or, you know, you're not going to have to do any of those things. Do you think you're even going to have to plant a seed? No, because you have a living creature. Pick up that seed, go, oh, I like that seed, and take it somewhere else and then drop it and that's where it gets planted. That's how God's system works. And all of a sudden you have a mango tree grow up and, wow, I've got a mango now. Like, and eventually these living systems can reproduce at all times. So at the moment there's seasonal cycles because there's certain periods of abundance and certain periods of lack. If there was abundance consistently, can you see that eventually things would genetically modify to the point, or they'd genetically mutate to the point where they'd be able to replicate at any time of the year? So you'd be left with a garden that has 12 months harvesting, right? All year round mangoes. That's what you'd be left with, wouldn't you? And this is because the intelligence is present in these systems that have this ability, but only if the conditions are correct. And this is where our intelligence comes in. We can create the conditions to make this happen, but we can't do it if we keep basing our practice upon old techniques. Now, I've said many things about this, and I want to read some of them out to you because I think it's important to mention them. Firstly, that each organism knows how to create abundance for its own survival. This includes you, by the way. If man leaves each organism alone, in time it will create its own abundance. If man does not see nor acknowledge the intelligence in the system, then the organism cannot create abundance. The intelligence already in the system will correct the environment. All we need to do is learn how to support the intelligence. Now, if we take this fully, you can see that for us to create decent soil, we don't actually have to mine anything from the earth. We don't have to get gypsum or minerals or any of these other things, right? All we need do is create a system that allows the things that would normally provide those minerals back into the ground to provide them. That's what we need to do. So we need to have enough intelligence to discover that system and create it. That's all we need to do. And the intelligent creatures will find out what's wrong with the soil and they will automatically fix it for us. And many of you go, well, how long would this take? Might it take thousands of years? No, it can happen in tens or even in 1 year, a lot of these systems. Because remember, a lot of these systems have 1 year or less life cycles. A lot of the insects have 1 year or less life cycles. Their intelligence is present for a period of time. They have the ability to ramp up, do their job, and slowly decay away in balance. Right? Remember I said last time I spoke with you, I think, that we had all these, they're called cobbler's pegs. Do you know cobbler's pegs, the weed, so-called weed? We just had, after 1 year, we just had millions of them. You couldn't walk anywhere without getting them all over yourself. And my initial thought was, gee, I'm starting to get worried about these cobbler's pegs, right? I didn't need to worry about them. They're all doing a job of intelligence, right? Two crops of them, and you know now we've hardly got a cobbler's peg on a property. Didn't poison them, didn't get rid of them, Just let them grow, do their thing. They're edible, by the way, as well. Just let them grow, do their thing. They're hardly on the property at all now. Why is that? Because they were let do their job. The job that they were created to do, that they have intelligence to do. That they can do better than I can. And if I just let them do their job, it all repairs. And in fact, what I started realizing is actually, all these weeds that everybody thinks are weeds, I need to harvest the seeds. And I need to write down the jobs that each one of them did to the ground. Because whenever somebody else's ground needs that, all I could do is pick up some of those seeds, spread it over the ground. It's going to do the same job. Because each one of these things has intelligence. Right? It's very important to understand that. So now, I'm only halfway through this chat. Now, it's probably time to stop. So what I'd like to do is continue this chat with you again, if I can, of the other half. But at this point, I think the main thing is that I wanted to say to you is this. The three things that we've covered so far are, we need to understand that love needs to be brought to everything in the system. That's number one. We need to understand that if we do not bring this love into the system, then of course there will be imbalances that will be created. Now, number two is that we need to understand that each system only really needs us to help it with three things: water, food, and shelter. That's all. Each system needs only these three things. We need to understand what water, what water is obvious, what food, and what shelter for a system to survive. But all it needs is three things, those three things. And the third thing that we've just covered is that intelligence is inbuilt in every system and inbuilt in each individual part of each system. And if we have this intelligence working for us, it will do jobs that we would normally have to do manually by ourselves. Right? And if we have an understanding that all we need to do is give food to the systems, which means we need to give dead systems to the system, we need to give dead things to the system, because most of these creatures won't eat live things. Most of the food that is needed for the recovery of the ecosystem won't be based on live things. It'll be based on what is already dead. Right? And if we understand that, then we can start designing systems that have a large degree of the ability to recover whatever land we have, whatever we have as a responsibility. So even if we just have a backyard, the same principle applies than if we have 15,000 acres. We just need to understand the basics of the system. Now, that's half of what I would like to discuss with you. The second half is more how to place these particular things that we've discussed into some kind of practical solution that is usable. Does that make sense? And that's what I'd like to focus on in the second half. To do that, we have to start understanding the constituents of each system. In other words, we have to see what are the things that we want to multiply first. What are the things that we want to firstly feed? Now, can I suggest to many of you, just to investigate this over the next week or so, until we get the chance to continue this discussion, investigate the systems themselves. So, for example, some things I would like to mention to you. Have you noticed that when you turn up a rock, the rock can be on terrible ground, but it can be sitting there for 6 months or something, or a year on terrible ground. You dig the ground next to it, it's like hard as a rock, literally. It's almost as hard as the rock itself. But you lift up the rock, And underneath the soil in the under the rock is softer. It's better soil. Now, you can't say that it came from the rock. What did it come from? It's a shelter for a living system that changed the soil, right? It's just a rock, and yet it's a shelter for a living system that changed the soil. You can actually dig with the pick there, and it will go in much deeper. You try and experiment. You know, you'll have to sort of mac up a few living systems to do it, but you'll at least understand it in the end. That once you put some shelter down, just shelter, not even food or water, just shelter, all of a sudden there's a system that gets created that starts changing the soil. So when we run around like mad hatters fixing our soil, we'd be better off putting a heap of rocks down and just letting the creatures underneath there fix our soil. Can you see that? Right? How many of us think of doing that? What do we do with our rocks? Put them all in a pile in the corner or something. You know, build a wall out of them, get rid of them, dump them somewhere, put them in a different type of a garden perhaps. These are the things we do. Why do we do that? Because we're not conscious of what they do. Just a piece of tin laying on the ground for 6 months. You lift it up underneath, you'll see all living creatures, right down to snakes underneath the tin. So you'll see living creatures from little tiny insects, fungus and bacteria, right up way through the spectrum to mammals or reptiles living in there. And that's just a piece of tin. You didn't do anything else. Now, if you took an active role in creating the system, imagine how much benefit you could have. If that's an inactive role and what it does, imagine how much benefit it could have to create an active role in you being the active person in creating the system. And that's what we're going to experiment with. Well, that's what we've been experimenting with at home for probably last year or 2 years now. And it's just remarkable the changes that happen very, very rapidly if you create these systems. Now, it doesn't matter if you only have the means to create one. And it doesn't matter if you only have the means to create one this big, one living system that big. It will have an amazing benefit to everything around it. That's what we've found. So what we want to do is start using these basic fundamental principles that we've discussed in understanding the intelligence, understanding the basic building blocks of what they need, the basic food, water, shelter, and also how love affects the entire system. And then we want to cover a couple of more issues, the actual organisms in the system. And I think the other issue was, the actual process of creating a healthy system. We wanted to go through that. And then we want to show you some techniques, if you like, some practical techniques that can be utilized. But if you could, at this point in time, allow the next few weeks to experiment with your own systems. Try to find out more about what they need with those three basics, the food, water, shelter. Do some experiments at home about if you give them food, what happened? If you give it a bit more shelter, what happened? Measure it, and you'll see what I'm talking about to be true. Does that make sense? But just try the experiments. Because once we start understanding these basic building blocks, we can then go to the next step. And the next step is to actually start using our intelligence to support these intelligent systems instead of using our intelligence to destroy them. And the more we support these living systems, and the more we help them, you'll find they'll give you back far in excess of what you gave them. Because there are billions and billions and billions of these living creatures, all with intelligence, that can all be working for you rather than against you. And the only way they're going to be doing that is if we bring ourselves into harmony with love and start to love them through our actions. Does everyone get that? Yeah? How does that sound? Yeah? So hopefully if you can attempt some of these experiments. Now, the outline that I've done for this talk I will be placing on the net so that you can download it and just have a look at the rest of the outline. And that way you can see some of the things that I've missed discussing with you. There's quite a lot of pretty good material in this outline that I would have liked to have discussed with you. We're hoping that we can put together a two-hour session that sort of summarises a lot of what we've discussed and will be discussing, so that people can watch it on the internet in 15-minute intervals, so 15 minutes at a time, with me and Igor and a few others that have been filming, going around on the land and showing you different things. Does that make sense as a part of the presentation? And that way, we're hoping to have that as an introduction to anybody who wants to do work on any of the learning centres, in terms of volunteer time and effort. But you'll find it of immense benefit to your own properties, if you own your own property, if you're renting a property, to your own backyard and your own gardens and things like that. The same principles apply. Yeah. So, like, we're having a lot of fun, aren't we, Darlin, with building our living systems. We're usually out 2 or 3 hours every day building another living system of some kind. And it's amazing, the living systems that we've taken a good care with, and there's only been 2 or 3 of them at this point, that we've taken really, really good care. You know, we've got it down to a bit of a fine art now in terms of caring for it. It's just remarkable. Like, we can bare root plants that have been quite high, big plants, bare root them completely because they're a bit root bound, pull out all of their roots, get rid of some of their dead roots, replant the plant, without the plant having any shock whatsoever and continuing to grow the next day. That's never happened to me before, right? And it's all to do with dealing with some fear and addressing some issues emotionally, but also just how you look after the system. Yeah. So it's just pretty remarkable what can happen in a system. We're also doing some experiments, partly what we'll be doing when we're down at Summerfest is some experiments with living systems. We've already started them down there, the last visit. We'll be continuing a few more and hopefully being able to show you some of those systems as a part of your education if you come down to Summerfest in Kentucky.
Just on that... Mm-hmm. It would be very helpful if people are intending on attending Summerfest.
Just come over here.
Yeah. Okay. If you are planning to attend Summerfest, it would help us a lot with the planning if you could RSVP. So by the end of this month, by the 31st of this month, to event@godswayoflove.org. So if you do plan to come,
so
it's
just
like...
just write that down.
You know, we're not going to hold you to it...
If you have to change your mind,
it'll be okay. But at the moment, we're sort of operating without any idea of what kind of numbers are thinking of coming. So if we can have an idea, it will help us to make things a lot more smooth during the week.
So it's event@godswayoflove.org.
It's just events.
Yep. Okay, so how have you found today's discussion? All right. What we want to do is show you it a bit more in practice. So I'll be doing some more theory presentation to you, maybe next time we get together. I'm not sure when that will be. We really need to do it to give Igor we probably need to do it soon, don't we? We've still got this hired for next week, haven't we? Or it's no longer hired? Oh, it's just been cancelled. Yeah, well, I've only presented half the information and Igor is going to need the other half of the information before he can do the editing, and we need to get the editing done at least 2 weeks in advance of Summerfest. So probably the best thing to do is to have, if any, would you like to come along next week and discuss the other half? So maybe if we even just do that at, what time would suit most of you? Same time? Or would you like it later? Speak up. Later for many of you? Do you want to do it? Should we do it in the evening-ish, about 6-ish or something like that? Would that be better? 6 till 9 or something like that? Is that all right? Yeah? That'll help for those who are working during the day. Yeah, basically what we're trying to do is get a video presentation together so that any person who comes to Summerfest, if they haven't watched it, the very first thing they'll be doing in the morning is watching it, right, to learn these particular things. Because we want people to be more educated before they go out onto the property than what they currently are with regard to what we're attempting to achieve. Yep. So, and that's going to involve quite a lot of editing and stuff like that. So we want to get as much of the material together as possible. So what probably we'll do next week is we'll do a bit more shooting down the Learning Centre on the same day, perhaps. It's Wednesday, isn't it? We mm-hmm. have it here. And then the trouble is we've got to travel Thursday, don't we? You're travelling Thursday, we're travelling Thursday. I'm just trying to think what we're going to do. We'll be right doing it Wednesday. I'm just wondering whether Tuesday might not be a better day for us to do this. And if it's already been cancelled, Joy, is that what you said?
And we've just taken it as a credit for another booking. So, yeah.
I'm wondering if we maybe book it for Tuesday next week rather than Wednesday. And okay. Tuesday, okay with most of you? It's just that that'll give us the extra, because we're travelling down to Kentucky next week as well. Yeah. So if we make it Tuesday night?
I'll put it on the blog, on the events page. Yeah. So
it'll be Tuesday night, 6 o'clock. That doesn't suit some of you? No? Sorry about that. And we'll record the entire session and put it on, but we'll also be editing the session and putting it together into more bite-sized chunks. So, yep. Okay. Thank you. No, not really.